Well, good morning.
Good morning.
We are grateful to God that you're here on this special day. We have got a service where we're going to recognize our seniors. I'm going to read some scripture in a moment, but I'm Pastor Chris, and we're glad you're at First Chapel this morning. This is an important season. It's an important season, important recognition and milestone in the life of these seniors, and so we're going to read some scripture, and I'm going to pray, and then we're going to see our seniors march in. And then Josh is going to take over for a good bit of the day. But don't worry, I'll be back. I want to read to you from the 104th Psalm, verses 35 and following. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. Who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let sinners be consumed from the earth, and let the wicked be no more. Bless the Lord, O my soul, praise the Lord. Join us as we pray. Father, we are grateful to be in your house this morning, to be in your presence, to worship, to recognize these graduating seniors, to recognize this milestone in their life, but to bless them, and to bless their futures. Father, I rejoice in the goodness of this church. I rejoice that there's a stage full of babies for baby dedication, and there's a stage full of graduating seniors that have a connection here. Grateful that we have a church that on Wednesday many students come and hear the gospel. Father, I'm grateful that we get a chance to worship you today. We pray that in this time, in this little bit of fraction of time we have in this week, in this moment, on this day, we would honor our Savior, your Son, and that we would genuinely and truly worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Each of you, and then just recognize you as individuals.
So you all are going to come up. You're going to get a, we have a Bible for you. We have a card for you. You ladies, we have a flower for you. And then when I am done, you will come up on stage and you'll get that. You got to take a quick picture with us. And then a little later, I'm going to come back up here after a couple of worship sets. And then I am going to come back up here and give you guys a charge from God's Word this morning. All right? So we are recognizing 12 seniors this morning. So our first senior that we're going to recognize this morning is Mr. Christopher Atkins. Christopher has been homeschooled and he is graduating early at an accelerated pace. Christopher is the son of Tom and Jennifer Atkins. Some of Christopher's future plans. Some of Christopher's plans include, what he plans to do is he plans to spend some time at the International Alert Academy in Texas. And ALERT stands for Air Land Emergency Resource Team. He is going to take part in their intense Christian discipleship training program, which forges young men to be spiritually sound and ready to serve in a military-like environment. ALERT has deployed teams to serve all over the world in disaster relief, missing person searches, and community service projects. Christopher's favorite Bible verse is 1 Timothy 4:12, and Christopher's favorite First Baptist Church memory includes going to attending summer camp last year. Our first graduate this morning, Mr. Christopher Atkins. Graduate number two this morning is Ms. Jessica Atkins. She is also graduating from homeschool, but she is also completing her two-year degree through Liberty University in criminal justice. And her parents are Tom and Jennifer Atkins. Jessica is graduating from Liberty with honors. She's also been involved with Beta Club at Liberty. She has also been awarded Florida Bright Futures. And Jessica has enjoyed serving here at First Baptist, working in the sound system. Jessica's future plans include to obtain her bachelor's degree in cybersecurity through Liberty University. Her favorite memory verse is John 15:18, and her favorite First Baptist memory is also attending camp last summer. Our second graduate is Jessica Atkins. Chiefland High School and is the son of Avery and Kimberly Baker. A few of Carson's accomplishments. Okay. So some of Carson's accomplishments include he is actually not only graduating from high school, but he has also earned his AA degree through the College of Central Florida. He has earned 100% Bright Futures scholarship, and he is the class salutatorian. Carson's future plans include to attend Florida Polytech University to get a degree in computer science. So him and Jessica definitely have the digital world covered for us in the next few years. But Carson's favorite Bible verse is Jeremiah 29:11-12. And Carson's favorite First Baptist memory is he said that he's enjoyed his time in the youth department, has especially fond memories for right at the beginning stages, probably when he was a middle schooler running rampant like some of you middle schoolers know what I'm talking about. But our third graduate this morning is Mr. Carson Baker. Number four this morning is Miss Grace Bastow. Grace is graduating from Chiefland High School and is the daughter of Matthew and Carrie Bastow. A few of Grace's accomplishments include graduating magna cum laude and being a Florida Medallion Scholar. Grace has been the senior class secretary, FFA president, and a varsity cheerleader where she served as captain this past year. She's also been on the weightlifting team, a part of SGA and leadership class, and she was voted most school spirit by her senior class this year. Grace's future plans include attending Santa Fe College to finish her AA degree and then transfer to UF to pursue a bachelor's degree in ag communications. And eventually, Grace would like to attend law school and have a career advocating for agriculture. Grace's favorite Bible verse is 1 Peter 5:7, and her favorite First Baptist memory is attending youth camp here, or youth camp in North Georgia, where she said it was a fun week with friends and adults growing close together. Our fourth graduate this morning is Miss Grace Baskin. So our fifth graduate that we're going to recognize this morning actually could not be here this morning, but we're going to still recognize her. And our fifth graduate is Miss Cassidy Bright. So Cassidy will be graduating from Chiefa High School and is the daughter of Mark and Denise Bright. A couple of Cassidy's accomplishments include she is graduating with her CNA license, and she's also certified with her BLS license, which stands for Basic Life Support. Her future plans include to attend Santa Fe College and obtain her AS degree to become a registered nurse, and then get her bachelor's degree in nursing while she works as a labor and delivery nurse. Cassidy's favorite Bible verse is Matthew 5:16, and Cassidy's favorite memory is attending Sunday morning worship with her family. So our fifth graduate, again, she's not able to be here this morning, but it's Miss Cassidy Bright. Sixth graduate this morning is Miss Alora Brown. Alora is graduating from Bell High School and is the daughter of Andy and Laura Hawk. Some of Alora's accomplishments include she has multiple national rankings showing dogs and rabbits. She has been involved in 4-H since the age of 5. She's also been a member of FFA since 9th grade, and she currently serves as vice president on the Florida 4-H State Council. Alora's future plans, you most certainly can probably guess, involves animals. But her future plans include to attend Florida Gateway College to finish her AA degree. Then she would like to transfer to UF to major in animal science, specializing in animal biology with a minor in extensive education in hopes to attend vet school to become a veterinarian specialized in reproduction. Alora's favorite verse is Jeremiah 29:11, and her favorite memory, First Baptist memory, is spending New Year's in Gatlinburg, even though she was left at the hotel and they had to come back again. Sixth grade this morning is Miss Alora Brown. Our seventh graduate this morning is Miss Aubrey Brown. Aubrey is graduating from Trenton High School and is the daughter of Jason and Stephanie Brown. Some of Aubrey's accomplishments include being on the varsity volleyball team, the cheer team, the soccer, and the softball team. She also was a proficiency finalist in fruit and nut production. She's also been an active member of FCA, and she is also graduating in the top 10 of her class, where she is a straight-A student. Aubrey's future plans include working at Gibson Select while completing her degree in business, and then she would like to obtain her realtor's license. Aubrey's favorite verse is John 15:7, and her favorite First Baptist memory is starting the new tradition of attending First Baptist with her grandpa every Sunday morning. Our seventh graduate this morning is Miss Aubrey Brown. Graduate number 8 this morning is Miss Ella Gore. Ella is graduating from Chiefland High School and is the daughter of Adam and Kelly Gore. Some of Ella's accomplishments include being a member of SGA, FCA, Leadership, and Beta. Ella has been a cheerleader for 4 years. She has been a dual enrollment student. She was awarded the Florida Medallion Scholarship, and she is graduating in the talented top 20 of her class this year. Ella's future plans include to major in early childhood education and become a teacher. Ella's favorite Bible verse is Matthew 17:21, and her favorite First Baptist memory was helping paint the pastel wall with the cross on it in the youth room with her friends. Our eighth graduate this morning is Miss Ella Gore. ninth graduate this morning is Mr. Trevor Gulledge. Trevor is graduating from Chiefland High School and is the son of John and Tasha Gulledge. A few of Trevor's accomplishments include being a member of the golf team and the baseball team. Trevor is proud of the fact that in his 4 years of high school baseball, his team made 3 regional appearances, and he is also very proud of the bomb that he hit this year. Trevor's future plans include working at Sanchez Farms until he gets his CDL license and then become a lineman. Trevor's favorite Bible verse is Psalm 23:4, and his favorite First Baptist memory is Trevor says he enjoys coming and being a part of Wednesday nights here at First Baptist with his friends. Our ninth graduate this morning is Mr. Trevor Gulledge. Graduate number 10 this morning is Ms. Claire Horn. Claire is graduating from Chiefland High School and is the daughter of Todd and Brandy Horn. A few of Claire's accomplishments include being a member of SGA and FFA. Claire has played volleyball and softball. She has also been dual enrolled while working towards her AA degree. So Claire's future plans seem to change daily, but right now she plans to stay local and attend Santa Fe College and eventually pursue a degree in business. Tomorrow it might be something in the dental field, but Claire knows that God will direct her paths. Claire's favorite Bible verse is John 16:33, and Claire's favorite First Baptist memory, Claire has loved Wednesday nights, but her favorite memories include going to winter retreat and summer camps. Claire said there is something special about getting away from the daily routine and spending time together. Our 10th graduate this morning is Ms. Claire Wood. Number 11 this morning is Mr. Evan Thomas. Evan is graduating from Chiefland High School and is the son of John and Lori Thomas. A few of Evan's accomplishments include being an active member of SGA and FFA. Evan ran cross country and played baseball. Evan was a member of the homecoming court, and Evan was voted most likely to brighten your day by his senior class. Evan's future plans include to attend Santa Fe College and work in the construction field. Evan's favorite Bible verse is 1 Corinthians 10:31, and Evan's favorite First Baptist memory is going to various summer camps and learning more about God, making new friends and memories. Our 11th graduate this morning is Mr. Evan Thomas. Include being a member of the HiQ team for 5 years. Orrin has been an officer in beta and competed in the state engineering contest twice. Orrin has been an officer of the Interact Club and attended RILA. He has also been a member of SGA where he served as the treasurer this year. Orrin's future plans include to attend the University of Florida starting this summer to study science and possibly to focus on genetics working in a research lab. Orrin's favorite Bible verse is Genesis 1:31, and Orrin says his favorite First Baptist memory was he really enjoyed Wednesday night with everyone, both the lessons learned and the fellowship. Our 12th graduate this morning, Mr. Orrin Wilson. Thank you.
morning, First Family. We're going to get started in a second. Thank you for allowing Hallie and I to be out last week. We visited up in D.C. our grandkids, and before I have this time, we're going to show you. Hallie snuck upstairs for our little granddaughter. She was working with her magnet tiles, and she was singing this song. We're going to sing it this morning.
Jesus died my soul to save.
charge that I am going to give you 11 here this morning is going to come from Paul's letter to the church in Corinth, found in 1 Corinthians 16, 13, 16. So and most certainly, church, you're welcome to turn there as well if you'd like. And so you'll notice these verses are pretty straightforward, pretty much to the point. And so you'll notice also as you turn there that the verse we're looking at here this morning is going to come really towards the very end of Paul's letter, which means this is usually when his letters begin to get a little more personal to his audience. So I'm going to read this morning from the New Living Translation, and Paul says this in verse 13. Paul said, "Be on guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. And do everything with love." So I think Paul's words here in 1 Corinthians most certainly can apply to you guys this morning, you 11, you graduates this morning, as you prepare to graduate and really then enter into your next season of life, whether that be college, whether that be work, whether that be both. And so I think here we really see Paul give the people of Corinth five reminders that I think will serve you 11 well as you enter this next season. So the first one being, number one, be on guard. So as you guys, as you graduate, step into the world, understand, and most certainly as many of you have spent a lot of time around me, I've tried to make it clear to you guys over the last few years, but understand there is a spiritual battle that is going on, and you need to recognize this fact. As you step out and you graduate high school, every single day there is a spiritual battle going on. And the enemy on the other side, Satan, Jesus reminds us in John chapter 10 that he only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Here's the thing, though. I would remind you 11, this. Satan doesn't have to have you do all of these quote-unquote terrible things to destroy you. He doesn't. All he simply needs you to do, you 11, is simply fall asleep spiritually. That's all he needs you to do to destroy you. So what I mean is, what does it look like to fall asleep spiritually? Well, I think some things would be this. I think busyness. I think simply filling your calendar with things that maybe get in the way of spending time with him, taking some time and spending with him. Things like we begin to, maybe you begin to make the decisions as far as you let people get in the way. You let things that maybe are not of his kingdom get in the way. And they fill up your schedule and your time. And the next thing you know, you're spiritually asleep. You're spiritually asleep. Because the fact is, the danger of it is, when you fall asleep spiritually, as you guys move forward, when you fall asleep spiritually, you are not being effective for God's kingdom. And graduates, I most certainly can assure you this morning that the God that you serve most certainly desires for you to be effective for the kingdom of God. So I would encourage you, number one this morning, as you step out into the world, be on guard. Be on guard. Paul then said, number two, stand firm in the faith. Stand firm in the faith. So number two this morning, graduates, I would charge you this, as Paul did, people of Corinth, stand firm. I said earlier, you guys really are a very intelligent group. You really are. I have most certainly witnessed that. And I think you guys all understand, I say as you step into the world, the fact is you've been in the world, but as you really step into the world here, I think you recognize you're stepping into a world that people continuously give way to the ways of the world and continuously waver. Listen, that does not have to be you. It does not have to be you. Stand firm. So how do you stand firm then? Well, I think the fact is, you know the answer if you spend any time around me, by knowing God's Word. And how do you know God's Word? By being in God's Word. So the only way to stand firm in the faith is to hold firm to God's Word. What is quickly becoming probably one of my favorite verses is Colossians 2, 6, and 7 says this, "Just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith, just as you were taught." So you guys, I think, know this, but you're going to have storms going to pop up in your life. I'd love to sit here and tell you that, you know, your life is going to be, you know, unicorns and rainbows. I'd love to sit here and tell you that this morning. But I think you guys know that there's going to be storms that pop up in your life. Well, the fact is, much like a tree or a plant, that makes it through those storms and continues to stand through those storms. The ones that make it through are deep-rooted. The ones that make it through are deep-rooted. So we are reminded here, Paul reminds us in Colossians, to stand firm, to make it through those storms of life. And so that is how you are to make it, is to be rooted in Him. So graduate number two here this morning, I would charge you, stand firm in your faith, so that, and you would be rooted and built up in Christ. Number three this morning, be of courage. Be of courage. So depending on the Bible version you have, the language may differ here some. As a matter of fact, I know some say, act like men. Ladies, most certainly, I'm not going to tell you that this morning. And you guys, I'm most certainly not going to tell you that, like ladies. Probably the world will tell you that enough when you get out there in it. But the bottom line here is, Paul is encouraging the church to be courageous. Guys, we need men to step up and to be courageous. Ladies, we need women to step up and to be brave. We do. Listen, I've said this many times before, but walking for Christ is not for the weak. It's not for the weak. It takes courage. It takes bravery in a lost and a dark world. In a world that does not act or live according to the standard of God's word. So you need to be of courage. There are going to be moments in your life, in your next season of life, where you are going to have to decide to stand on God's word or you're not. So I charge you this morning, graduates, number three, decide to be men and women of courage in your next season. Number four this morning, for sure, be strong. Be strong. Grace, good news is you've been on the weightlifting team, so you're there, right? No, but so when Paul tells the people of Corinth to be strong, so this is language for keep increasing in strength. Keep increasing in strength. The only way to do this is to be obedient. To be obedient to the Spirit and allow Christ to give you the strength. One of the most famous verses in really the whole world is probably what? I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Right? Everybody loves to remember that one. But we have notice here, graduates. The fact is, this strength is not your own. It is given from Christ. It's His. That strength is His. On your own, hate to break it to you, but you're not strong enough. You're not strong enough. But the good news is that you serve a Savior who loved you enough to come take residence up inside of you and to give you the strength you need as you enter this world and you enter this next season. So graduate number four this morning, I would charge you, be strong in the strength of the Lord. Last one this morning is number five, let all that you do be done in love. So I think this is the one that really holds it all together. I mean, really just a few chapters before, in chapter 13, Paul reminded us that faith, hope, and love remain, but the greatest of these is what? It's love, right? It's love. The fact is, it is impossible. It's impossible to talk about living for Christ and not talk about this powerful four-letter word of love. You have a Savior. I'll remind you this morning. You have a Savior who is love. We are told that love comes from Him. And I would encourage you this morning, as you go out to share this love with folks, as you go out into the world. Listen, I've seen many of you sitting here this morning already really begin to do this, selflessly, sacrificially love others. I have. I've seen it. But I would charge you this morning, number five, love most certainly by telling others of the Savior's love, but also in all that you do, as Paul said, as you go out. Listen, you 11 here, you really are. You are a special group, and you guys are going to be faced with many decisions, most certainly in the coming days, the coming months, and even in the years to come. But my hope would be that you sitting here this morning would go into this new chapter of your life with one decision that's already made. One decision that's already made, and that is that you are going to stand firm with Christ. Alright? Church, if you would join me this morning, please, and praying for these graduates as they head into their next season, and then I'll turn it over back over to Mr. Denny. Please join me in prayer this morning. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, so much for being able to come into your house this morning. Lord, we just lift up these graduates here to you this morning. I thank you so much for the relationships that are here, Lord. I thank you so much for this group and how you've blessed them already tremendously in their life, Lord. And then, Lord, I pray here this morning that you would bless them as they go out into this next season of life. Lord, I pray that you would help them, Lord, as they go out, that they would be on guard. Lord, that you would give them a wisdom, that you would give them protection as they step foot into their next new exciting season in their life. Lord, I pray that you would help them to stand firm on your word. Lord, I pray that you would give these here a love for your word. Lord, there is no replication of your word and what it shows us. And so, Lord, I pray that they would go out and stand firm in your word. Lord, I pray they would go out and they would be strong, that they would be courageous, Lord, and decide to stand for you, Lord, recognizing they're stepping foot. They know, Lord, in a world that so many, Lord, we can't expect the world to live for you. And so, Lord, I pray that you would give them a recognition of this, and they would decide to be strong. They would decide to be courageous in this world. And then, Lord, I pray here this morning that they would go out in love. Lord, that they would spread your love with folks as they go out. And that, Lord, they would truly love in their words and in their actions, Lord. And that they would let their light and shine for you, Lord, and for your glory. That they would go out and be salt, whether that is here in Chiefland, whether that is in the Tri-County area, whether that is in the state, this country, across the nation, Lord, whatever it may be, wherever you lead them, that they would hold fast to you and your word. And I pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we continue in worship, quick announcement. For those of you that are in the choir, or the dozens of you that were going to surprise me this afternoon and show up for choir, because of all the activities that are going on this afternoon in preparation for the baccalaureate, we will not have choir practice today. Let's all stand together and sing, "You Are Worthy of My Praise." Guys, follow the guys, and ladies, follow the ladies.
I will seek you. I will seek you.
I'm supposed to come and charge the church. The problem with that is everything I wrote sounded like a charge to the students. And I had Josh's notes, and everything I wrote sounded like what Josh was saying. And by the way, I should say this, Josh is a gift from God. Amen. Amen. I'm grateful that he is leading our students. I'm glad that my kids are in his student ministry. And he's a man who loves the Lord, and it's a parent who loves these students. And so I'm supposed to charge the church. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to charge you a lot. You should laugh at church. It's good for your soul. I want to read to you from 1 Timothy chapter 4. And I want to give you just four quick, very quick things about the church and about young adults. 1 Timothy chapter 4 says this. Let no one despise you for your youth. Verse 12. But set the believers an example in speech, conduct, love, faith, and purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, your exhortation to teaching. Do not neglect the gift you have, which was given you by the prophecy when the council of elders laid their hands on you. Practice these things. Immerse yourself in them so that all may see your progress. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing, you will save both yourself and your hearers. So I want to charge the church in this way. I want you to think about what will happen when these young adults get of age. What will happen when these young adults get to a place where it's their time to serve the church? So here's what needs to happen in the church. Because we're here until Jesus comes again.
Amen.
And we need to be ready and prepared. And we need the best and the brightest leading our churches. So here's just four quick thoughts. One is, don't despise their youth. Isn't it interesting that Paul is writing to Timothy, and Timothy's a young rookie preacher, and he's kind of giving him some encouragement. This is a good scriptural, biblical pep talk to a young rookie preacher. And he says, Timothy, let no one despise you for your youth. It implies this to me. We look down on young adults. We often think they don't have the experience. They can't lead. They can't be in places of leadership. I did ask Kelsey if I could ask this, but if you feel a young adult like Kelsey is qualified when you have a sinus infection, shouldn't someone of the same age be able and available to lead in the church? I did ask that permission. Don't despise their youth. As young adults come to age in the church, let them serve. Don't say things like, I think they're too young. Second thought would be, when they set an example, let them serve and lead. The Bible says, Paul tells Timothy, let no one despise you. Then he says, but set the believers an example. He's saying to these young adults, to the young adults in our church, he's saying to those 20-year-olds and 30-year-olds, you should be an example. And then I think when they're an example, we ought to let them serve. Now, we most of the time have no problem letting them serve. Heck, yeah, put them in the kitchen, put them in the kids department, put them in the youth department, put them in places. Let them serve, serve, serve. But when it comes to a moment where they ought to be leading the church, we think, well, now, wait a minute. Let's not get carried away. We need the 50 and 60 and 70 and 80-year-olds doing this. When good, godly young adults have done what the Bible tells us they should do, which is setting an example for the believers in their speech. This is just what Josh has told them to do. In their speech, in their conduct, in their love, in their faith, in their purity. In other words, when they've been living the life that Christ called them to live, and they're in the church, and they're of age, and they're of good reputation, we should say, you know what? Maybe I can give you some of the reins. Maybe I can let you lead. Because here's the thing. This church and other churches are going to exist until Jesus comes again. So we want young and fresh leaders leading the church. Sure, they may not dress like we dress. They may not think like we think. They may be different, but if they're good and they're godly and they love Christ, we ought to let them serve and we ought to let them lead. I would say, what's a charge for you? What could you do? What could you do for these students? What could you do for the students in Brooks' ministry, the students upstairs in Josh's ministry, the young adults? Right, I got a class full of young adults in my Sunday school class. We got kids right now progressing, or I think the word is matriculating. Some of you don't like that word because you didn't do it very well. Matriculating through college. Here, what can you do as a church for these people? Here's what you could do. One, you could pray for them. You could pray for them. When you see those young adults in church, you don't even know their names. In some cases, just pray for them. Pray for these young adults as they get ready to go out into a bright, vibrant, and sinful world. Pray for them. Pray for the challenges. Listen, there are real challenges in college and in the workplace. You should pray for them. You should watch them grow. Should watch them grow. It's humbling. It's humbling to hear my children say things that are spiritual things. To say things, well, if that's what God calls you to, if that's the will of God, what does the Bible say about that? And I can see them right before my eyes growing in the Lord. I'd say we just pray for these students and then we watch them grow. We watch them grow. And then ready for this? Let them go. Not just into the world, but let them go in the church. Let them do ministry in the church. Let them lead ministry in the church. Let them serve on committees. Let them be in places of leadership. We send them out into the workforce. Soon they'll be managers. Soon they'll be working on genetic projects and fixing us, hopefully, in some way. We'd let them do that. But we hold the church in a sort of trust where we think we have to hold on to this as long as we can. And here would be the fourth thing. I was going to hope I didn't have time to get to this one, but I do. You'll hope I didn't have time to get to this one. Maybe we should just get out of their way sometimes. See, in the church, we hold on to this stuff. Even though, and again, in a way, it's despising their youth. We're despising their youth. But yet they've set an example. The Bible said they've set an example in speech and conduct and love and faith and purity. They've done these things. And then they've even gone a step further of devoting themselves to the public reading of Scripture, exhortation, and teaching. They're not neglecting the gift that God's given them. They're doing the things like Timothy's doing. And then I think we ought to just get out of their way in some cases in the church and let them lead for the Lord. God's called them in many ways to do many things. But yet again, we hold on to things because we're afraid, because this is the thing we often hold so precious to us, and we want it like we want it. But God's called an entire new generation. I'm telling you, the things I hear, not just from these students, the things I hear from other students, that are the things that are going on in the world as kids are taking years and going and doing ministry, and they're feeling a real call to missions, and they're feeling a call to preach and to teach. It's going to be a new and supernatural blessing to the church. But listen, some folks will have to move out of the way. Some folks will have to get out of the way and not despise the youth and say, Lord, I'll find a new place to serve. And these that God has called and equipped and talented with great gifts, let them serve the church and watch it grow as they grow. Here's what we're going to do in a minute. We're going to stand. We're not really going to have an invitation. We're going to sing. We're just going to sing a closing song and some announcements and prayer. We're going to sing the goodness of God. I pray the goodness of God on their lives. I do. I pray the goodness of God on this church. I pray the goodness of God on whatever churches they serve. They're going to go all over the world. Who knows the churches they're going to fill up one day. I pray for our young adults to go and to lead. And listen, a new generation leading is really the goodness of God in this world. Let's stand together and pray, and then we're going to worship. Father, you're good to us. Your gospel's good. Your kingdom is good. The stories we've heard today, these lives, they're good. Those in Christ, they're good. The church is good. Father, your gospel and your love is on display. I pray for these students, but I pray for us in the church that as a new generation is equipped and called, that we would welcome them. We would give them a place at the table. We'd let them be stakeholders. We'd let them be leaders. We'd let them do what God's called them to do. We not despise their youth. We let them set an example. Father, as we sing, just let us worship you. Let us, for just a moment, appreciate your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen.